Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, we have a report on the limits of human life expectancy. Brian Lynn brings us this week's science report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first, a new study says humanity is hitting the upper limit of life expectancy. Developments in medical technology and genetic research are not leading to major increases in lifespan overall, the researchers said. The study was published recently in Nature Aging. We have to recognize there's a limit and possibly change ideas about when people should retire and how much money they will need to live out their lives, said S.J. Olshansky of the University of Illinois, Chicago. Olshansky was the lead writer of the study. Mark Hayward of the University of Texas was not involved in the study. However, he called it a valuable addition to the mortality literature. "We are reaching a plateau in life expectancy," he said. "It is always possible that some new development could push survival to greater lengths, but we don't have that now," Hayward said. Life expectancy is an estimate of the average number of years a baby born in a particular year might expect to live. The measurement assumes death rates at the time of birth do not change. Life expectancy is one of the world's most important health measures. Still, the life expectancy measurement has problems. For example, life expectancy is an estimate that cannot include new developments or changes that might affect the length of people's lives. These unknown developments could include pandemics or new treatments for diseases. In the recent study, Olshansky and other researchers followed life expectancy estimates for the years 1990 to 2019. They took information from a database administered by the Max Planck Institute for Demographic Research. The researchers paid special attention to 8 of the places in the world where people live the longest: Australia, France, Hong Kong, Italy, Japan, South Korea, Spain, and Switzerland. The United States does not rank in the top 40, but it was included in the study because the researchers live in the U.S. Also, some experts had made estimates that life expectancy in the U.S. would increase greatly in the 2000s, Olshansky said. Women continue to live longer than men. Female life expectancy improvements are still happening, but at a slower rate, the researchers found. In 1990, the average amount of improvement was about 2.5 years every 10 years. In the 2010s, it was 1.5 years, but almost zero in the United States. Life expectancy measurements in the U.S. are more difficult. The country is affected by a number of causes of early death. Examples include drug overdoses, shootings, weight problems, and uneven healthcare services. But in one calculation, the researchers estimated what would happen in all 9 places if all deaths before age 50 were prevented. The increase at best was still only 1.5 years, Olshansky said. The study suggests that there is a limit to how long most people live, and we have almost hit it, Olshansky said. We are squeezing less and less life out of these life-extending technologies. And the reason is aging gets in the way, he said. It may seem common to hear of a person living to 100. Former U.S. President Jimmy Carter, for example, recently celebrated his 100th birthday. In 2019, a little over 2% of Americans made it to 100, compared to about 5% in Japan and 9% in Hong Kong, Olshansky said. It is likely that the number of people who reach 100 will grow in the years ahead, experts say. But that is because of population growth. The percentage of people hitting 100 will remain limited, likely with fewer than 15% of women and 5% of men making it that long in most countries, Olshansky said. I'm Ashley Thompson.
Scientists say they have successfully reproduced corals to improve their resistance to warmer ocean temperatures. The latest effort is one of many that seeks to prevent major coral destruction events known as bleaching. The scientists blame the bleaching on ocean warming caused by climate change. Coral bleaching happens when the small ocean animals react to climate pressures by releasing algae organisms that provide them with energy and give them their color. If the bleaching is severe and long-lasting, corals can get sick and die. Scientists and environmental officials have warned major bleaching events are currently affecting ocean coral collections in many areas across the world. Many researchers link the continued warming of Earth's oceans to climate changes related to human activities. In April, the U.S. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA, and International Coral Reef Initiative said at least 53 countries, territories, or local economies reported ongoing bleaching events since February 2023. The latest research aimed to reproduce corals that can become more resistant to warm ocean temperatures. To do this, the researchers used a method known as selective breeding. Scientists have long used this method to produce animals and plants with more desirable characteristics. This process can produce living things that are better able to deal with or tolerate different environmental conditions. Selective breeding is now a main method used by scientists to study how the process can prevent ocean warming from killing off corals. The new research was led by scientists at Britain's Newcastle University. The team recently reported their findings in a study appearing in the publication Nature Communications. The study said their selective breeding methods resulted in improved heat tolerance of adult corals even within a single generation. Scientists have for years been observing corals that show more heat-resistant qualities. These corals are used as the parents for new corals. The researchers said their experiments showed that breeding heat-tolerant characteristics into different corals could be a useful tool to improve population resilience. However, the team noted the method would likely not be enough by itself to effectively protect corals. This is because increasingly intense ocean warming is expected to continue if additional steps are not taken to reduce the worldwide effects of climate change. The scientists noted, therefore, that methods to reproduce heat-resistant corals must be a part of overall efforts that require urgent climate action. The research team's experiments were carried out during a 5-year project launched by Newcastle's James Guest. The effort received financial support from the European Research Council. The team said it carried out selective breeding tests involving two different characteristics. The first sought to improve the tolerance to the release of a short, intense heat event over 10 days with a temperature rise of 3.5 degrees Celsius. The second tested results for a less intense but long-term temperature rise of 2.5 degrees Celsius over 1 month. The study found that selecting parent colonies for high rather than low heat tolerance increased the tolerance of adult offspring. The result was observed for corals experiencing either a short, intense heat event or a long-term temperature rise. The team estimated that about 25% of the increased heat tolerance was linked to genes passed down from parents of the corals. These genes can also be influenced by other selective breeding methods to produce heat tolerance characteristics, the researchers said. Newcastle researcher Liam Lax helped lead the study. He said in a statement, "The research clearly demonstrated that selective breeding can be a valuable tool in improving the health of corals influenced by warming oceans." However, he noted, "The tested methods are not a complete solution and that more research is needed to maximize breeding results." The researchers said they plan next to lead efforts to carry out large experiments on corals in the wild to confirm the study results. These efforts would involve seeding selectively bred corals directly on ocean reefs or deploying corals raised in a laboratory. I'm Brian Lynn.
Now, Brian Lynn is here to talk more about his science report. Thanks for joining me, Brian.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week, you reported on a successful effort to reproduce corals that are more resistant to warming ocean waters. The report noted that corals in many parts of the world are currently experiencing heat-related problems. Where did the scientists involved in this study center their research efforts?
So, yes, this group of researchers was from Britain's Newcastle University. For several years, they have studied corals attached to reefs in the island nation of Palau in the Western Pacific. It is interesting to note that about a year ago, The scientists released another study showing it was possible for the corals they studied to develop characteristics that were more resistant to warmer ocean temperatures. And these were characteristics developed, although at a very small level, on their own, as a reaction to the ocean environment. So once they learned this, it opened the door for their experiments involving selective breeding methods.
And what makes Palau such a good place to carry out these experiments?
Yes, so the researchers noted this country sits in a place with very developed reef structures and many, many different kinds of coral, some of them not found anywhere else in the world. Palau is a collection of more than 300 individual islands and is also home to extensive reefs covering more than 500 square kilometers. Experts from America's NOAA agency have estimated this island nation has several hundred different species of reef-building corals. And because of its location and ocean resources, Palau has become a valuable research target for scientists studying corals, as well as other things related to conservation and climate change.
All right. Thanks again for joining me, Brian, and thank you for your report.
You're welcome. Thank you, Ashley.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. You're listening to the Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In a recent Lesson of the Day podcast, we talked about Anna going to the store to buy food for a dinner party. In Lesson 39, which is called It's Unbelievable, we see Anna shopping online. She sees an advertisement on television and, as you can imagine, learns an important lesson about advertising.
Winter weather in Washington, D.C. can be really windy. And wind messes up my hair. It is really windy today. Oh, look at my hair. Will it be windy this weekend? I'll listen to the news. I am tired of my untidy hair.
Are you tired of your untidy hair?
Yes. Yes, I am. And it's uncomfortable.
Is it uncomfortable?
Yes. Yes, it is. Hey, is that Pete?
Hi, I'm Pete, and I have the perfect product for you. Hair Be Good. Just spray Hair Be Good on your hair. Wrap in a towel. And you are done. Hair Be Good works. And it's inexpensive. One can costs only $10. So go online and order your Hair Be Good today.
Hair Be Good sounds perfect. And I can trust Pete. I am buying some right now. Okay, I will order one can of Hair Be Good for $10. I'll pay with a credit card. My delivery will arrive in 2 days. Awesome!
We should add that in Let's Learn English, you can find lesson plans with many activities and explanations like the ones we give you in this podcast. For example, there's a pronunciation practice video about the feeling Anna describes for her untidy hair.
One of the new words in this lesson can cause problems for English learners. That word is uncomfortable, and its opposite, comfortable. When you say this word, you do not pronounce some of the letters that you see in the written word.
In this lesson, you hear Anna say that her hair is uncomfortable.
Are you tired of your untidy hair?
Yes, yes I am. And it's uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable. Uncomfortable. Hey, that sounds like one of those reduced forms we've been teaching in some of our earlier podcasts.
Yeah, are you happy? It wouldn't be a lesson of the day without a reduced form.
That's right. Let's listen to more of the story. I want to find out if the hair product helps Anna fix her hair.
I'll use it before I go to work. Okay, hair be good. Make my untidy hair tidy. No, make it fabulous.
Hi, Anna.
Hello, Amelia.
Anna, you look different.
Thanks. I used a new product called Hair Be Good.
Well, it's not.
It's not what?
Good. Your hair does not look good.
Oh, no! This is not good.
Why don't you go home and take care of this?
Good idea.
Listeners, we need to describe for you now how Anna's hair looks in the video. It's standing up straight from her head in all different directions. You could say it's even more untidy than it was before.
It looks very strange. Now you can guess that Anna will be very unhappy with Pete when she meets him on her way home from work. Let's listen.
Hi, Anna.
Hello, Pete.
Is something wrong?
This is wrong.
What did you do to your hair?
Hair Be Good did this to my hair.
Oh, you bought it.
Yes, I bought it. You said in your ad it was a perfect product. This is not perfect. This is imperfect.
It's unbelievable.
I believed your ad, Pete. It was dishonest.
I hope this doesn't damage their friendship. And by the way, you probably figured out that untidy means not neat. In this lesson, you hear Anna use adjectives with negative prefixes. Prefixes are those little two- or three-letter pieces that come before a word and change its meaning. The prefixes in this lesson are the letters I-N, in, the letters U-N, un, the letters D-I-S, dis, and the letters I-M, im.
Hey, we had an example of dis in our previous podcast when we talked about Anna and the guy from the country disagreeing.
That's true, we did.
And like I said before, Anna is really unhappy with Pete because she believed his TV ad. She didn't know it was a dishonest ad, one that was not really telling the truth. So it was unbelievable.
Thanks, Jill, for those examples of how those prefixes give the opposite meaning to an adjective. Like when Anna tells Pete that the product in his advertisement does not work.
Yes, I bought it. You said in your ad it was a perfect product. This is not perfect. This is imperfect.
In this example, imperfect means the opposite of perfect. The prefix is im or im.
I suppose our listeners are wondering why there are so many prefixes to make the meaning opposite. Dr. Jill, do you have a linguistic explanation for that?
Of course I do. One reason is that English words were borrowed from several different languages. One of them is German. Words from German use a prefix un or un. And a lot of words come to us from Latin through other languages like French. Those words from Latin use the prefix in or in.
Okay, but what about the other prefixes like I am as in imperfect? Perfect comes from Latin, doesn't it?
Yes, but the prefix in or in changes to im or I am before adjectives that begin with P, B, and M, as in impossible and imperfect.
So there, it changes because of the sound of the next letter. That makes sense. There are some important words that take the IM, im, like import, immunize, immortal.
And important, too. There are two other prefix sound changes like that. The prefix in, I-N, changes to I-L or ill before the letter L, as in illiterate or not able to read.
That's right. If you are literate, you can read, and if you are illiterate, you cannot read. That prefix also gives us words like illegal and illogical. And isn't there one more prefix? IR, ear. The letters IN, in, changes to ear before words that begin with R, as in irresponsible, which means careless.
Right, so we get irregular and irrelevant. But let's get back to our story. Will Anna forgive Pete?
Anna, you don't believe everything you see in ads, do you?
No, Pete. Just the ones with my friends.
Your hair will be okay. Just wash it a couple of times.
Thanks. Thanks a lot, Pete. Here's your product. You should call it Hair Be Really, Really Bad. Until next time, Pete. Till next time.
I guess it will take a little time for her to forgive him. But she's learned not to believe everything she sees on television.
That gives me an idea, Andrew. Let's ask our listeners to write to us about some advertising they learned that was not 100% true. Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or in the comments on our YouTube video.
And here's a useful vocabulary word for our listeners. An advertisement that is very untrue, we call that a scam. S-C-A-M. So perhaps you have encountered some scams, but hopefully not. And whether you find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, or on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com, we hope you have enjoyed the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast.
And thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.